a great pleasure and honor to be here. Thank you for coming at this early hour. If we tried something at 8 o'clock in Harvard, you would get a seat pretty easily, I think. So thanks for coming. Today, as you well know, is a rather solemn occasion. It's the 13th anniversary of the 9/11 attacks on mostly on this city. And I thought I would really talk a little today about remembrance and some of my own experiences of violence and conflict when I was, I think, roughly the same age as most of the people in the room. Memory and its close associate remembrance, how we select and edit our lives for our own consumption, are very important human traits that help us affirm our identities and help us to reflect on our values. Today, as you all know very well, is the 13th anniversary of the 9/11 terrorist attacks, which took almost 3,000 lives, most of them in this city. As it happens, this year is also the 100th anniversary of the outbreak of the First World War. And this is something that was more deeply remembered back in Europe because, as you know, the United States came into the war 3 years later, so it'll be, I guess, 2017 when most of the important memorials will be here. Now, these two events, 9/11 and the outbreak of the First World War, are not unconnected. The First World War ended with the collapse of the Ottoman Empire, the further assertion of British and French imperial power in the Middle East, and the redrawing of state boundaries in the Middle East, which have haunted us ever since. What history teaches us is that wars and violence rarely solve the problems that occasion them, and almost always set in train a set of conditions that make future conflict unavoidable. The First World War was described as the war to end all wars, but of course its terrible tentacles extended to the origins of the Second World War and to decades of instability in the Middle East. Wars have long consequences in human affairs, but they also have very particular human consequences for those caught up in them. One of the most moving literary products of the First World War is a memoir by Vera Brittain called Testament of Youth, the film version of which will be released later this year, so please look out for it. She tells the story of her youthful aspirations to attend Oxford University and of her happy relationships with her talented brother and fiancé. Like millions of others in 1914, they were busily making their plans with youthful exuberance and hopes for the future. Those hopes were tragically destroyed by the war. Brittain's brother and her fiancé were both killed during the war, several other of her close friends. The passage in Testament of Youth, when she first learned of her fiancé's death, cruelly the very day that she expected to greet him home on leave from the front, is one of the most evocative passages of shattered youthful dreams in all of literature. She writes, quote, "A solitary cup of coffee stands before me on the hotel breakfast table. I try to drink it, but fail ignominiously. Outside in front of the promenade, dismal gray waves tumble angrily over one another on the windy shore." Vera Brittain later married, but her daughter, the eminent British politician Shirley Williams, who also taught at Harvard, stated that although her mother successfully rebuilt her life, she never again experienced unmitigated or unshadowed joy. War was a permanent scar on her psyche. Shirley Williams wrote of her mother that, quote, "At the back of her mind, the row upon row of wooden crosses were planted too deeply." Now, many of the families and loved ones of the victims of 9/11 will know all too well what this feels like. Although I was far from New York on that tragic day 13 years ago, these matters have a very direct personal resonance for me as well. Please permit a few autobiographical reflections. I was a high school student in Belfast about your age in 1968 when what has been become known as the Northern Irish Troubles broke out. Like many of you, I was taken up with my studies, my college aspirations, playing sports, dating, music, having a good time, avoiding homework, and all of the other things that I'm sure are in some of your minds. The trouble started with some civil rights marches, then some responsively brutal police violence, then some ugly urban riots, and growing political instability. I nevertheless felt insulated from what was going on. There's that kind of confidence of youth. I was confident that things would soon settle down, that we'd get back to listening to the Beatles and the Rolling Stones, and I could get on with the other things I was interested in. I remember vividly being jolted out of my complacency when the very first death occurred in 1969. This seemed to be something of a new level of seriousness. But still, I would never have believed that the Troubles would last a further 30 years, with a death toll considerably more than that resulting from 9/11, in a province with a population less than a fifth of that of New York City. So almost everyone in Northern Ireland knew someone who had been killed, injured, affected, or suffered loss. Now, mercifully, violence did not touch me as closely as it did Vera Brittain or the families and loved ones of 9/11. But it did cast a long shadow over my adulthood. In 1970, I went to college in Queen's University in Belfast, and over the course of my four-year degree, more than 1,000 people were killed. Life became a blur of young men with masks and automatic weapons in their ubiquitous paramilitary organizations, armed soldiers and armored cars patrolling the streets, seemingly endless succession of funerals, through gray urban landscapes or dreary, melancholic Irish country lanes. What made the Northern Ireland situation all the more challenging for me is that religion, while not the sole cause of the problem, and it almost never is, was unmistakably bound up in the wider conflict. Grafted onto ancient divisions between Catholics and Protestants were competing nationalisms, significant cultural differences, and unequal access to economic and political power between the two sides. These conflicts are always more multi-layered and more complicated than we think. So one piece of advice I would give you is to think hard about how these things happen. So here was my personal dilemma, which alas, to some extent, has become the dilemma, I think, of your generation. I had seen the good side of religious devotion in my own family and among thousands of faithful and compassionate believers who courageously reached out to serve people of both traditions through the dark days of the Troubles. But I also saw firsthand the hard edge of religious bigotry, exclusivism, militancy, anger, and violence infected by polluted religious ideals. I was so intrigued by this paradox that I've spent much of my life thinking and writing about it. I now find myself dean of an eminent divinity school in Harvard and wondering what is our responsibility in a world in which religion has emerged as a major component in conflicts from Iraq to Gaza, from Myanmar to Nigeria, and many, many other places besides. I realize that for you too, as leaders of the future, this is, or soon will be, a very real question for your generation. There are, of course, many intellectuals at Harvard and elsewhere who believe that religion is itself the major part of the problem, an ancient evolutionary weakness fanned into terrible flames by globalization and civilizational conflict. They assert confidently and often convincingly that what the world needs is less religion, certainly less angry bigotry, and more secular enlightenment, more prosperity, more respect for human rights, and better statecraft. Now, much of this is incontrovertible and desirable, but we also know that not all human conflict is motivated by religion, and that religious values and commitments have, in many situations, played pivotal roles in inspiring and informing efforts to end conflicts and reconcile divided communities. We also know that while war exacerbates human suffering, it doesn't have a monopoly of it. We all need to figure out ways of dealing with the tough sides of human life, not just conflict and war, but how to live meaningful lives, deal with tragedy and loss, and find sustainable happiness. A few days ago, the New York Times columnist David Brooks wrote that elite schools and universities have become less interested in these moral questions, preferring instead to focus purely on cognitive functions, just acquiring more information, how to think better. And he really notices that there's been a seismic shift in how we're educating. So what then is to be done? At Harvard Divinity School, we see ourselves as trying as best we can to fulfill three missions. First, to generate and transmit knowledge about all the world's great religious traditions. And in doing so, promote greater understanding and hopefully more respect and tolerance. This first goal is not just about understanding religion, but also understanding religion's contributions to civilizations and to the humanities. Second, we try to learn to cope with and even dare to celebrate the religious and human diversity that unfortunately seems to wreak such havoc in the wider world. And thirdly, we try to train ministers and those in other service vocations to help make the world a better place. As we teach at HDS, ministry can be any vocation a person chooses, from religion to business. What matters is not so much what we do, but how we do it. That we seek to be friend and guide, that we try to illuminate with knowledge, to engage the other with empathy, and most of all, to serve something greater than ourselves, community, humanity, and if we're a believer, God. When we follow this approach, we often find that meaning and purpose finds us, rather than the other way around, even in the face of great uncertainty and adversity. I want to end by circling back to my introduction and the distinction I made between memory and remembrance. Memory and remembrance are both fundamental parts of being human. As you get older, memory becomes a more fundamental part of being human. In his book, A Room Called Remember, New York-born minister and theologian Frederick Buechner recommends serious reflection about our past as a serious spiritual discipline. He writes, quote, "The time is ripe for looking back over the day, the week, the year, and trying to figure out where we've come from, where we're going to, for sifting through the things we have done, the things that we have left undone, for a clue to who we are and who, for better or worse, we are becoming, the people we are becoming." Now, the discipline of self-reflection is good in itself, but remembrance takes us one step further from that. Remembrance is to memory what love is to ethics. Remembrance is relational, it's reflective, it's redeeming, it's reforming. Remembrance is about giving thanks for the lives of others, not just our own. And it's about taking time to appreciate lives lived and sacrifices made that our lives may be better as a result. Remembrance is not mere nostalgia, nor is it the glorification of terrible things. It's a solemn and sacred act of empathy and gratitude. It's also an act of fierce determination to make the world a better place, not just for ourselves, but for everyone. In that sense, it's a profound, even a defining opportunity. It reminds us that regardless of what those who came before us did and how daunting may be the legacy of the challenges they have left for us in the present, we, as individuals and members of communities like this one, have the opportunity to learn from the past and to be contributors to a better future. Alas, the Great War, despite its unprecedented carnage and futility, did not turn out to be the war to end all wars. And 9/11 will not be the end of vicious terrorism in our world. The challenge for us then is both intellectual and spiritual. As students, how can we better understand both the conditions that produce violent conflict and some of the approaches that can help resolve it and hopefully even prevent it? This is a serious, important task. Simply responding by force to force all the time will not solve this problem. So one challenge is intellectual. The other, I think, is spiritual. As people of faith in something greater than ourselves, or as people who want to live meaningful lives with purpose, How do we propose to live? And what difference are we going to make? Thank you.